Good evening, everyone. Tonight we are going to be giving a transmission of the refuge vows as well as the five lay precepts.
那么我们守节之前要给大家介绍一下，给大家讲一下什么是皈依节，什么是居士节。
But before we actually go about taking the vows, I'd first like to explain what they entail.
首先，皈依就是我们这个整个的学佛的第一步。Starting
with the refuge vows, taking refuge is our first step on the Buddhist path.
学佛就是要从皈依。 开始，然后一步一步的学。Our
practice of Buddhism starts with the taking of refuge and then proceeds step by step from this place.
然后这个皈依节是我们的所有的佛教的戒律的基础。And
the refuge vow is also the foundation of all the other ethical vows and ethical discipline in all of the Buddhist traditions.
那么我们自从受了这个皈依节以后，我们就正式的进入了佛门了。From
the very point that we have accepted the refuge vow, then we can consider ourselves to have formally entered into the gate of the Dharma.
我们自从受了皈依节以后，正式的。 成为释迦牟尼佛的四中弟子之一。And
from the point that we take the refuge vows, we can also consider ourselves formally a member of the fourfold student community of the Buddha.
那我们，比如说我们还没有皈依的时候，我们对佛有信心，还是很虔诚。然后呢，我们平时也有做一些善事，但是呢，就是因为还没有皈依，所以这个时候呢，我们还没有入门，这个时候还不叫 真实的佛教徒。
Before we've taken the refuge vows, it's possible that we may have great faith in the Buddhist teachings, that we may be very sincere and dedicated followers of the Buddhist teachings. We might engage in a lot of virtuous action too. However, until the point that we have actually taken refuge vows, then we are not, formally speaking, students of Buddhism.
那么我们学佛的时候呢，因为学佛，它有很多的层次，它有很多的环节，那么这个每一个环节都要做得好。如果前面的做好，后面的也自然也就做得比较好。
The path of Buddhist practice has many different levels. If the level prior to where one is has been completed well, then the subsequent levels also follow in a positive way. So it's important that we commence our path of practice in a proper fashion.
所以我们如果真的想认认真真的去想学佛的话，那么我们精良的就每一个环节都要做得比较认真一点，这样子我们以后的学佛是有比较有成就。
So if we really sincerely and diligently want to study the Buddhist teachings, then it's important that each stage and each level of practice we attend to properly.
好，首先我们第一个我们讲这个皈依的时候呢，我们需要四个方面给大家介绍这个皈依。
So in respect of the refuge vows, there are four important aspects I'd like to talk about.
首先我们今天我们大家都是来皈依的都是来皈依的。那么我们皈依的时候皈依谁呢就是第一个皈依佛第二皈依法第三就是皈依僧。
So the first thing is to be clear about the objects of our refuge. Everyone who is here tonight has come to seek refuge, and that means seeking refuge in the Buddha, the Dharma, and the Sangha.
首先佛是什么？我们简单的要了解一下什么是佛释迦牟尼佛、阿弥陀佛等等。这些叫做佛。
So when we speak of the Buddha, we're referring to the Shakyamuni Buddha, we're also referring to other Buddhas such as Amitabha.
然后第二法是什么呢？法就是凡是释迦牟尼佛传下来的法不管是南传的、北传的、藏传的、汉传的还有各种各样的显宗的、密宗的这些都叫做法。凡是佛法都叫做法，这是第二个。
And the second object of our refuge, the Dharma. What is classified as the Dharma? Well, any teachings that were transmitted by the Buddha. So this includes all the teachings of the southern tradition, the northern tradition, Chinese Buddhism, Tibetan Buddhism.The Sutric tradition, the Tantric tradition, all of these are encompassed by the object of refuge, the Dharma.
第三就是僧众僧众是从大乘佛教的角度讲，像观世音菩萨、文殊菩萨等等这些菩萨叫做僧众。然后从南传佛教的角度讲。比如说四个以上的这个出家人的团体叫做僧众。
And then in terms of the third object of our refuge, the Sangha, from the point of view of the Mahayana tradition, bodhisattvas such as Manjushri and Guanyin, they are the Sangha for the purposes of the Mahayana definition. And then for the Theravadan tradition,Any community of four monks or above can constitute a sangha.
好，这三个啊，是我们今天的这个皈依处佛法僧，是我们的皈依处啊。什么叫做皈依处呢？就是我们今天来皈依啊。那我们皈依谁呢？就是皈依佛、皈依法、皈依僧。
So these three put together are the objects of our refuge tonight. We've come here to take refuge, and those things we are taking refuge in are precisely the Buddha, the Dharma, and the Sangha.
我们很多人啊，以为，比如说我给你们传这个皈依解的时候呢，很多人以为是来啊皈依我的啊，但是呢，实际上不是皈依我啊，我是帮你们啊做这个皈依的仪式啊，皈依就是有一个简单的仪式啊，我来给你们做这个仪式，实际上你们不是来皈依我啊，我们大家都是皈依佛、皈依法、皈依僧啊。这个首先我们对这个皈依啊需要有一个比较正确一点的认识。
Some people may be of the understanding that tonight they are taking refuge in Khenpo himself, but in actual face, that's not the case. Here in his presence, he is assisting everyone in giving the ritual of taking the refuge vows. The object of everybody's refuge is the Buddha, the Dharma, and the Sangha. So it's important for us to have a proper understanding of what it means to take refuge in the presence of a teacher.
好，然后这是第一个啊，叫做皈依处。首先我们要知道我们是来皈依谁的，所以首先给大家介绍皈依处。好，这是第一个。
So we've just covered now what the objects of our refuge are. The first thing, of course, to be clear about is what we are taking refuge in.
好，第二个啊，那我们学佛为什么要皈依啊？需要皈依的理由是什么啊？第二个给大家简单介绍一下为什么要皈依的原因。
And the second point I'd like to speak to briefly are the reasons for which we seek refuge.
那我们有些人觉得这个皈依啊，它就是一种行持啊，皈依就是一种仪式。那为什么要有一个这样子的仪式呢？我自己直接去学佛啊，为什么不可以呢？为什么有一个这样子的仪式呢？啊，有些人就有这样子的想法。但是呢，我们为什么要皈依，还是需要有一个，还是有一个原因。
Some people wonder why it's necessary to take refuge since it is just a ritual. Why is it necessary to go through this ritual? Why can't we just apply ourselves directly to the study of the Buddha's teachings? However, there is a reason for which we take refuge.
我们皈依就是为了学佛啊。那么学佛我们可以这样子理解，学佛是什么呢？我们向释迦牟尼佛学习啊，这叫做学佛。那向释迦牟尼佛学习什么呢？就学两个啊，两个，一个是向释迦牟尼佛学习释迦牟尼佛的智慧，这是第一个。第二个呢，我们向释迦牟尼佛学习释迦牟尼佛的慈悲心啊，慈悲心，就这两个，我们向释迦牟尼佛学习。学习什么？就学习这两个，那么这个叫做学佛。
First of all, we need to have a proper understanding of what it means to be a student of the Buddha's teachings. Primarily, in being a student of the Buddha's teachings, we are learning from the example or the wisdom of the Buddha. And here we are speaking of this in two senses, the Buddha's wisdom on the one hand, and then the compassion of the Buddha on the other hand. So this, the Buddha's wisdom and the Buddha's compassion, these are the two things and the only things that we are learning about.
好，那我们学习啊，学佛的话呢，就我们需要具备三个最基本的条件。
In order to be students of the Buddha's teachings, it's necessary that we fulfill three criteria.
比如说一个学生啊，在学校学习的时候，他就需要具备三个最很基本的条件。
Just like a student who is studying at school, it's also necessary that they fulfill three criteria.
那么第一个条件是什么呢？他需要一个很优秀的老师啊，如果没有老师，没办法学习。
The first criteria that needs to be fulfilled for their study endeavors is to have a qualified and a well-qualified teacher.
第二个啊，就是需要有所学习的内容啊，就是教学的课程啊。如果这个学校有非常优秀的老师，但是呢，学校没有给我们提供啊这个教学的内容，或者是说这个老师啊没有给我们教任何的东西啊，那这样子的话，这也是没有用的。所以呢，第二个条件就是需要有教学的内容课程。
And the second necessary criteria is that of a proper educational curriculum. Just having an excellent teacher is in itself not enough. If that teacher doesn't teach us anything, or if they don't have any materials to rely on, then our education experience will not come along well.
第三个条件啊，第三个条件就是我们要进入一个学校的话，就需要家长的帮助，还有这个同学的帮助，以及比如说他的这个学校里面的工作人员的帮助，这是第三个条件。
And then the third thing that is needed for a proper study situation is a supportive environment, including supportive parents, supportive classmates, and also supportive administrative staff.
好，只要有了这三个条件，他就可以安心的学习啊。同样的，我们学佛的时候呢，也需要具备这三个条件。
So with these three criteria fulfilled, it's possible for a student to go about their study in a manner without worries, without concern. And so it is for us as students of the Buddhist teachings.
好，首先第一个啊，那我们学佛的时候，我们也需要一个老师啊。那我们的老师是谁呢？释迦牟尼佛啊，就是我们的老师。
So, in respect of who our teacher is, that is the Buddha. The Shakyamuni Buddha is our teacher.
那么释迦牟尼佛啊，2500多年前就圆寂了。那今天我们怎么把他当作我们的老师呢？
However, since the Shakyamuni Buddha in fact passed away 2500 years ago, how is it that we can make him our teacher or regard him as our teacher nowadays today?
释迦牟尼佛圆寂了，但是呢，就是有很多很多的人，比如说从释迦牟尼佛的年代到我们现在这个时代，就一代一代一代下来的这些上师这些师父他们呢就是释迦牟尼佛的主手，他们都是释迦牟尼佛的主手，他们就是给释迦牟尼佛完成释迦牟尼佛的这个教学的工作就是帮他完成这个工作。
Even though the Buddha Shakyamuni passed away 2500 years ago, all of the generations of teachers and masters that have succeeded him from that time until the present can be considered as his teaching assistants. They have assisted the Shakyamuni Buddha in carrying out his curriculum of teachings.
所以这些人他们给我们教的这些东西都不是他们的，都是来自于释迦牟尼佛那么他们比如说我们的上师我们的上师的上师，这样子一代一代的这些 过去的这些所有的菩萨、阿罗汉、所有的上士啊，那他们讲的、他们传递的都不是他们自己的，都是他们在讲释迦牟尼佛的思想、释迦牟尼佛的这个观点啊。那么我们的这个，我们今天学的这个啊，这些东西的源头就是佛，所以我们的老师释迦牟尼佛。其他人都是释迦牟尼佛的主授。
However, the source of all the teachings we receive is the Shakyamuni Buddha, regardless of whether it's our own teacher or our teacher's teacher or our teacher's teacher's teacher or the various arhats and bodhisattvas of the past. They weren't teaching their own teachings. Their teachings derived primarily from the Shakyamuni Buddha, and so this is why we regard him as our primary teacher.
所以啊，释迦牟尼佛今天不会他亲自来给我们教什么，因为我们没有办法看到佛陀。但是呢，很多人很多很多的人帮释迦牟尼佛做这个工作，所以我们每一个人的上师每一个人的师父是非常的重要，非常的关键。但是呢他们教的与这些东西的来源是释迦牟尼佛，所以呢，我们还是最后我们的真正的老师，我们还是要作为释迦牟尼佛。
So even though all of us sitting here don't have the fortune to have the Shakyamuni Buddha face to face as our teacher, our own teachers and our own masters serve extremely vital and important roles. They are nevertheless ultimately assistant teachers of the Buddha, and because what they are teaching us ultimately derives from his source, therefore, we regard him as our primary teacher.
所以我们要皈依释迦牟尼佛。然后呢，到底什么叫做皈依？我们等一下给大家解释。
So for this reason, the first object of our refuge is the Buddha, and in what we actually mean by taking refuge is something we'll go on to look at shortly.
好，然后第二我们要皈依佛法。那为什么要皈依佛法呢？就是因为佛法就是我们所学习的内容，就是教学的内容，所以我们皈依它。
As for the second object of our refuge, the Dharma, the reason that this is our second object of refuge is that it comprises the content of our educational curriculum as students of the Buddhist tradition.
还有这个僧众僧众我们刚刚讲了什么是僧众。那么僧众是就像我们的同学一样那僧众很重要，学佛的时候，因为佛现在我们没办法看到它。然后呢，虽然有很多很多的佛经但是这些佛经，我们自己去看，我们自己去读，我们不明白，我们学不会。所以呢，我们要靠这个僧众僧众来给我们解释，来给我们传递这个佛的思想和佛的观点。所以，我们学佛离不开僧众的帮助，所以要皈依僧众。
And then our third object of refuge, the Sangha, is extremely important for us in our study of the Buddhist teachings. As mentioned just before, we don't have the opportunity to have the Shakyamuni directly as our teacher. Whilst there are a great many Buddhist scriptures, just reading them by ourselves, we're unlikely to be able to gain an accurate understanding. So it's for this reason that we really depend on the role of the Sangha to assist us in our study of the Buddhist path.
好，这个是我们为什么要皈依三宝的原因，就是比如说我们刚才讲了学生要学习的时候需要老师，没有老师没办法学习。需要课本，需要这个课程，没有课程也没办法学习。需要 家长和同学的帮助，没有这个，同样也就是没办法学习。那只要有这三个条件就可以学习。所以我们学佛也是一样的，有佛、有法、有僧，我们可以学习。如果这三个都没有了，所以我们没办法学习啊，所以这就是我们要学皈依的这个理由啊，这就是为什么要皈依的理由。
So this is the reason why we take refuge. Just as if we're at school, if we don't have a teacher, we can't study. If we don't have materials to study, we can't study. And also, it'll be difficult for us to study without a supportive environment. As students of the Buddhist teachings, we rely on the Buddha, the Dharma, and the Sangha in our path of study. So this is the reason that we take refuge in these as objects.
好，这是第二、第三啊，然后我们给大家介绍，那到底什么叫做皈依啊？皈依的本质是什么？
So I'd like to move on to the third point, and that is what it means to take refuge. What's the fundamental meaning of taking refuge?
那到底什么叫做皈依呢？啊，烧香拜佛是不是皈依呢？啊，不是皈依。
Is making incense offerings and supplicating the Buddha taking refuge? No, it isn't.
诵经吃粥啊，这些是不是皈依呢？也不是。
Is reciting scriptures and chanting mantras taking refuge? No, it isn't.
然后我们做很多的善事，比如说我们去修炉、布桥、当义工，然后捐很多的钱啊，去做社会的公益活动、慈善活动，还有捐钱去修庙，那这些是不是皈依呢？也不是。
Is undertaking public works, building roads, being volunteers, contributing to charitable organizations, undertaking other meritorious acts. Is this taking refuge? No, these activities aren't taking refuge either.
好，那么这些都不是皈依，那到底什么是皈依呢？皈依就是一种决心，就是下决心啊，皈依就是一种决心。
So if none of these things are taking refuge, then what is taking refuge? Refuge, taking refuge primarily is a commitment or a resolve.
也可以这么说啊，皈依就是一种承诺。
Or you might say that, might say that.Taking refuge is a pledge.
也可以说皈依啊，就是一种宣誓。
Or a making of a choice, a commitment.
好，就这三个啊，下决心啊，下决心，然后承诺啊，这个宣誓啊，这三个实际上就是一个意思。
So regardless of whether we say it's a commitment, a resolve, a pledge, or a promise, ultimately we're talking about the same thing.
那我们啊，下什么决心呢？啊，承诺什么呢？宣什么？什么宣誓？宣什么誓呢？啊，首先要皈依的时候啊，首先我们皈依的时候呢，啊，首先要皈依佛。那么皈依佛的时候，我们每一个人心里这样子下决心啊，我们今天。有一个释迦牟尼佛的佛像啊，那这个就是代表释迦牟尼佛。我们在释迦牟尼佛的佛像前面啊，很庄严的、很严肃的啊，宣誓、承诺啊，下决心。
So when we go about taking refuge, particularly in the first object of our refuge, the Buddha.We do so before this image of the Buddha that we have here, and we undertake an extremely solemn commitment or pledge.
好，那我们在释迦牟尼佛的佛像前，我们宣什么誓呢？承诺什么呢？下什么决心呢？第一个我们皈依佛的时候呢，大家就可以心里做好准备皈依佛的时候呢，我们 在释迦牟尼佛的佛像前，我们下决心啊，从今天起啊，生生死死，释迦牟尼佛就作为我的唯一的导师啊。导师是什么呢？引导我们的老师，引导我们的上师，叫做导师啊。从现在起，生生死死，释迦牟尼佛就作为我的唯一的导师啊，这样子下决心啊，这样子承诺。那么这个承诺啊，这个决心叫做皈依，叫做皈依佛。
And so in front of the image of the Buddha, we solemnly pledge that from this time onwards, for all lifetimes to come, the Buddha will be our only spiritual guide. And in undertaking this pledge, we are taking refuge in the first object of refuge, the Buddha.
好，第二啊，第二个皈依法的时候呢，我们同样的在释迦牟尼佛的佛像前啊，我们很庄严的、很严肃的啊，下决心、承诺、宣誓，我从今天起啊，生生死死修释迦牟尼佛的法啊，只修释迦牟尼佛的法啊，不修其他的法啊，释迦牟尼佛的法就作为我的唯一的啊所学习的法啊，这样子下决心，这个决心叫做皈依法。
And then when we take refuge in the Dharma, again we do so with a very solemn and sincere attitude in front of the image of the Buddha, and we resolve or pledge that from now onwards, in all our lifetimes to come, that the teachings of the Shakyamuni Buddha will be our only, the only teachings we study, the only teachings we follow.
好，第三个啊，皈依僧啊，皈依僧众的时候呢，我们同样的在这个释迦牟尼佛的佛像前面，我们庄严的、严肃的宣誓啊，从今天起，生生死死学释迦牟尼佛法的僧众啊，不管是大乘的、小乘的，他们就是我的啊，这个道友啊，道友就是跟我们一起学习的同学一样啊，就是学佛的人就作为我的唯一的导游。除了学佛的人以外啊，学其他的人啊，那就是不作为我的导游啊，我的导游就是学佛的人啊，学佛的人啊，不管是学南传佛教的、汉传佛教、藏传佛教、什么佛教啊，凡是佛教啊，学佛教的都是作为我的导游啊，这样子，宣誓这样子下决心，这个决心叫做皈僧。
And then as when we seek refuge, take refuge in the Sangha, again we do so solemnly in front of the image of the Buddha, and this time we vow that from this point onwards, throughout all lifetimes to come, that we will follow in the example of the Sangha, and that members of the Sangha will be our only spiritual community. So regardless of whether this is members of the Theravada or Mahayana Sangha or Sangha from other Buddhist traditions, regardless from the point of view of who we consider as our spiritual companions, this should only be members of the Buddhist Sangha. And this is what it means to take refuge in the Sangha.
好，简单的说啊，简单的说，我们下决心，我从现在起，生生世世啊，乃至成佛之前，我就要啊坚定不移的走释迦牟尼佛给我们指的这条路啊，这条路啊，这样子下决心啊，这个简单的说，这叫做皈依。
So if we're to sum it up in one sentence, we might say that refuge entails us vowing from this point onwards until the point of our own enlightenment to unwavering and with great resolve follow the path as revealed by the Buddha.
这个就像我们在世俗的这个工作生活很多时候也是这样子，比如说我下决心我要去学医，我要当一名医生啊，这样子的话，那首先我自己要下决心我要作为一个医生啊，或者是如果他想做一位老师这样子的话，那首先他自己要下决心啊，我要作为一个老师啊，等等，都是这样子。首先他自己要下决心，他要做的事情啊，他要这个决定。同样的，我们今天也就是啊，我要作为一个佛教徒啊，下决心我要作为一个佛教徒。那么这个就叫做皈依。
So the making of resolve or the setting of resolve about what it is that you want to do is very important in everyday life. If one wants to become a doctor, for example, it's important that one first makes that resolve and then goes about the proper course of learning to attain that goal. It's the same for if one wants to become a teacher. And if we want to be students of the Buddhist tradition, the Buddhist teachings, then it's necessary for us to set our resolve properly at the beginning too. And this is what it means to take refuge.
好，这是第三啊，现在是第四，最后一个，最后一个就是皈依的这个动机，这个非常的重要啊。那我们今天大家都来皈依佛门，那么我们为什么要皈依佛门呢？我们的目标啊是什么？动机是什么啊？这是最后一个。
So we've covered three points related to the taking of refuge. The fourth and final point concerns our motivation, the motivation with which we take refuge. This is an extremely important point.
好，这个动机呢，每一个人有可能有不同的这个目标，不同的这个动机，因为每个人的背景不一样。但是呢，这个所有的我们的学佛的这些这个动机啊，可以分三种不同的动机，下等的、中等的、上等的，三个不同的目标。
It's possible that among everyone sitting here tonight, because of the fact that everyone has different backgrounds, that people's motivations in taking refuge are diverse. It's possible, though, for us to categorize the different motivations with which a person might take refuge into three: those of a lower, a middling, and a better level.
好，那么这三个啊，首先第一个下等的，下等最下等的是什么呢？比如说我们有些人呢，他不想成佛，他也不想成为阿罗汉，他也不想解脱啊，他不追求这些，这些都不追求。那么他追求什么呢？追求健康、快乐、幸福啊，还有这个发财等等。那么他就是为了达到这些世俗的生活上的这些利益然后来皈依佛门，或者是为了避免一些灾难来皈依佛门有这样子，这个目标是第一个是叫做下等的目标。
So the lowest level of basic motivation is one where the person taking refuge is not concerned with the goals of liberation or the attainment of Buddhahood, but rather is concerned with worldly concerns such as happiness and long life, financial prosperity, perhaps avoiding misfortune. This kind of motivation is what we classify as the lowest form of motivation in taking refuge.
好，这样子的目标可不可以皈依佛门呢？可以的，有这样子的目标的话，可以这样子的目标动机或者是用我们佛教的话来讲，以这样子的法行可不可以皈依佛门呢？可以的，但是呢，佛鼓励我们我们的目标应该稍微再高一点，因为这种目标呢， 全部都是为了现实，现实生活，所以这个目标很实俗啊，很庸俗，所以佛啊，佛鼓励我们啊，这个我们的动机稍微要再高一点啊，但是实在是就只有这一点想法，没有别的想法的话啊，也可以的。
Is it permissible or is it allowable to take refuge with this level of motivation or aspiration? It is. Of course, the Buddha encourages us to set our aspirations a bit higher from the point of view that this kind of motivation is oriented only to this current life. It's very worldly in its nature. So we are strongly encouraged by the Buddha to set our motivations higher in taking refuge.
好，现在是第二啊，第二个就是中等的这个目标。那么中等的目标呢，它不是为了现实生活当中的什么利益啊，它就希望啊了脱生死，从生老病死的这个轮回当中啊，获得解脱，为了获得解脱来皈依佛门啊。但是呢，它的解脱啊，只考虑自己一个人的解脱，那他没有考虑更多的人的解脱，没有考虑度众生啊，没有去想这些事情，只是为了自己一个人的解脱啊，皈依佛门啊。那么这种这个叫做中等的这个目标。
The second level of motivation, or what we describe as a middling level of motivation, is when the person taking refuge is not doing so primarily for concerns in this lifetime, but rather in order to be free from the sufferings of samsara. Their goal is to transcend samsara and its sufferings. Nevertheless, their aim in doing so is primarily for themselves. They are not particularly concerned with working for the liberation of other beings. This is what we refer to as the middling level of motivation.
那么这样子的目标可不可以皈依佛门呢？可以的，原则上是可以的。这个叫做小乘佛教的发心啊，小乘佛教的发心。但是佛鼓励我们就要再高一点这个目标再高一点。为什么呢？因为这个目标虽然是比前面的还好，但是呢这个目标也很自私很自私，只考虑自己一个人的解脱，不考虑更多的人的解脱，所以呢这个是很自私的，所以不是很完美不是很完美，所以佛鼓励我们这个发第三中心。
So, of course, it's possible to take refuge with this level of motivation, and this level of motivation can be considered as better or more preferable than the first kind of motivation. It is, though, what we refer to as the level of motivation of the basic vehicle of the Buddhist teachings. The Buddha encourages us to set our sights one notch higher and make our level of aspiration the third kind, however, from the point of view that this second level of motivation is still selfishly oriented. The person taking refuge is concerned about their own liberation and not so for the liberation of other living beings.
好，最后一个就是第三种第三种这个动机也是最高的上等的动机，这个叫做菩提心。
And so the third and highest form of motivation with which we can take refuge is also referred to as the motivation of bodhicitta.
那么菩提心呢，我们前两天也讲过了，讲过好几次了那么今天呢也给大家简单的说，那菩提心，什么叫做菩提心呢？需要具备两个条件有这两个条件就叫做菩提心。
So what we mean by bodhicitta is something that I've talked about several times over the past few days, but I'm going to recapitulate very briefly what it is we mean by bodhicitta. Ultimately, there are two criteria that need to be fulfilled.
好，首先第一个啊是什么？第一个条件是什么呢？第一个就是对所有的众生有需要有慈悲心啊，就是发现我们六道轮回当中的所有的众生，所有的众生啊，觉得我们大家都很苦啊，所以呢，我要去帮助他们啊，我要让他们远离所有的痛苦，我要让他们拥有心腹啊，也就是佛教经常讲的这个四个字，就是离苦得乐。我要让天下所有的众生离苦得乐啊，下决心我要去做这个事情啊，这就是我的学佛的目标啊。首先要有一个这样子的决心啊，这个是第一个条件。
So the first conditional criteria is based on a very strong feeling of compassion to all living beings, a sense of compassion that appreciates the great suffering in which they dwell, and based on this, a very strong aspiration to work towards assisting them from being free from the sufferings of samsara and attaining happiness. So it is this aspiration to workfor the benefit of living beings such that they may be free from suffering and attain happiness. This is the first criteria for the aspiration or motivation of bodhicitta.
好，第二个条件是什么呢？啊，那我要去帮助天下所有的众生啊，而且这个帮助就是不是一般的一个小的帮忙。而且就是让所有的人让他们成佛，让他们解脱，要做一个这么伟大的事情啊！虽然是我的这个发心啊，我的这种想法是很伟大，但是呢，我现在没有任何的能力啊。那么没有能力，我怎么让大家成佛呢？啊，那这个时候我们就会发现有一个方法啊。如果这有这个方法，我们可以做到这件事情啊。那是什么方法呢？首先，我自己成佛啊。如果我成佛了，那么我就可以让很多很多人成佛，让很多很多人解脱。我可以帮助特别特别多的人啊。所以啊，下定决心，我为了帮助一切人，帮助所有的众生，我要成佛啊。下决心要有一个坚定不移的这样子的决心啊，这个叫做菩提心。
And then the second criterion that makes up the motivation of bodhicitta is based on one's aspiration to work for the delivering of other living beings from suffering. A recognition that one's ability in respect of this goal is currently very limited. And so taking into consideration one's currently very limited capacities, one discovers that the sure method for being able to truly help other beings attain Buddhahood and achieve liberation is to first attain Buddhahood oneself. And by doing this, one's capacity to be of assistance to other living beings will be greatly enhanced. So with these two aspirations combined, we have a complete motivation or aspiration of bodhicitta.
因为我们每一个人都是天生啊，就是比较自私的，所以呢要有一个这样子的慈悲心和一个这样子的这个付出是不是很容易的，不是很容易。但是呢啊，逐渐逐渐的训练啊，逐渐的训练，那有一天，总有一天我们一定会有非常标准的菩提心啊。那么今天我们不一定有很标准的菩提心，但是呢没问题，我们啊强迫自己去这么去想啊，也就是比较被动的啊，比较被动的去想啊，造作的去想， 不是很积极，不是很主动，没问题。第一次的时候就不一定是很有很标准的菩提心，但是稍微比较被动一点啊，强迫自己去想，那这样子第一步的时候，这样子也是很不错的。
To have such a strong motivation of bodhicitta is not an easy thing to do at all, and it doesn't necessarily come immediately. It's something, a goal that we need to work on training ourselves in step by step. However, if tonight we are able to generate a, we might say, a more, somewhat we might compel ourselves to generate this aspiration, perhaps that might what seem for the time being a contrived level, then this is okay, it's a good place to start. And through our constant efforts in training ourselves, it's given that at one day we will be able to generate an aspiration of bodhicitta that is very automatic and genuine.
好，然后这个这个菩提心是我们不仅仅是今天我们受戒的时候要发菩提心而且我们做任何事情，比如说我们去念经、持咒，还有就是烧香拜佛还有学习打坐，反正做任何善事都要有这样子的发心我们的所有的心善都要就这个见都要在这个基础上去做，才能够叫做大乘佛法。
So it's not just tonight in taking refuge that we need to do so with the motivation of bodhicitta. Every time that we engage in positive or virtuous action, such as when we're reciting scriptures or chanting mantras, studying the Buddhist teachings or meditating, it's important that we do so with this attitude. And it should be the foundation on which all of our positive action is based. It's only through having this motivation as our foundation that we are truly practicing in the Mahayana path.
这个菩提心的功德是不可思议的为什么是不可思议呢？比如说平时我们看到十个贫穷的人或者是十个我们比如说病人十个病人我们看到十个病人那么我想去帮助这十个人十个贫穷的人或者是十个病人我要让他们离苦得乐，如果有这个想法的话，那么这个功德都是很大很大的。那这是仅仅是十个人只有十个人而且对他们的帮助也不是很大，我们暂时解决一下他的生活的问题，暂时解决一下他的肉体的这个疾病就这么一点而已，但是呢，这个功德都已经很不可思议了那么更何况天下所有的众生然后呢，让他们离开所有的痛苦，拥有最高的这个幸福这样子的心这样子的决心，他的功德是没有办法表达的，只能用这个四个字，就是不可思议。确实是这样子，功德特别特别大，所以我们要往这个菩提心的方面要努力。
The merit of a bodhicitta aspiration is inconceivable in its nature. Even if we were to generate an aspiration in respect of, say, 10 patients, 10 sick people, that they be well, that they be free from suffering, and let's say that we were able to assist them in taking care of their immediate livelihood needs and assist them in curing their immediate illness, then the merit of this action in itself would be incredibly large. So when we compare this to an aspiration of bodhicitta, which is directed to all living beings, the aspiration that they be free from all suffering and that they attain happiness, then the merit of this is so vast, it's inexpressibly vast, and that's why we can only use the word inconceivable to describe it. So it's very important that we orient ourselves to the training of bodhicitta.
好，我们第一个啊，皈依给大家讲完了，大家听清楚了没有？有没有什么疑问？
So that brings us to the end of the introduction of what the refuge vows entail. Has everybody gained a good understanding? Are there any questions at all?
大家听清楚了吗？清楚了啊，非常好。好，有没有什么疑问呢？
您说的十个
病人或者
十个生活问题，
对对对。
您是说，当我见到他，我心里的感觉就会觉得，哎呀，不轻不重。
对。
我就是希望他好起来。
对。
能够离苦得乐。
对。
还是我要去做一些什么事情去帮助他？
对。如果你去做的话，那这个功德就更加的大啊！如果你还没有什么实际的行动，只不过就是你心里就存一个这样子的好心啊，你是一心一意希望他们离苦得乐，那么这个功德也是很大的啊！更何况你还有一个实际的行动，好，那就。
我想问一下，就是这个菩提心和这个善心还有怜悯心有什么区别？
好，怜悯心和这个慈悲心呢差不多的，但是我们世俗的比如说爱心怜悯心、同情心等等，有很多很多比较相同的这个心啊，那么这个心呢都是非常有举贤性的，它的范围是很小很小的啊。那佛教讲的这个哦，这个怎么比如说，哦呀呀呀，佛教讲的这个慈悲心啊，它叫做无量心啊。无量就是说它是不分宗教的信仰啊，不分这个宗族，不分国界。不分这个肤色，它不分还有这个比如说像动物人类这样子的生命的层次，它对所有的生命发这个慈悲心，所以它叫做无量心啊，这个翻译一下。
So the first question was in relation to Khenpo's remarks about the merit generated by the virtuous thoughts of wanting to relieve the suffering of 10 people.And the question was whether or not the aspiration that these people be free from suffering and a feeling of great empathy for them is meritorious or whether it's necessary to undertake concrete action to help them. And Khenpo's answer was that just that sincere thought in itself, that sincere sense of compassion for them and a sincere wish that they be free from that suffering is incredibly meritorious.If in addition to that, it's possible to undertake concrete steps to relieve them of their suffering, then that's even more meritorious. And then the second question was in relation to bodhicitta and the difference between this notion and other ideas of kindness and love and empathy. And Khenpo's answer was that they're,are in fact similarities between them, but when we speak of compassion or bodhicitta in the Buddhist tradition, we usually associate it with the word immeasurable, immeasurable from the point of view that it's extended to all living beings. It's not limited in terms of the people or the objects that we direct our compassion and bodhicitta towards. And in respect of humans, for example, it does not recognize any divisions or boundaries between anyone on the basis of their race or nationality or religious faith or anything like this.
好，我现在接下来给大家介绍这个俱食节我们今天要收两种节一个就是皈依节，另外一个叫做俱食节。那接下来给大家讲介绍这个俱食节。
So tonight we are going to be receiving the transmission for two types of vows. The second is the five lay precepts. And so Khenpo now would like to introduce the five lay precepts briefly.
我们学佛啊，一个完整的学佛是什么呢？需要三个啊方面：一个守戒，第二个修禅定，第三个学智慧。啊，有这三个，我们的学佛就是很全面的，很完整的。
In terms of going about studying Buddhism in a thorough and comprehensive way, we usually say that there are three necessary things. The first is ethical conduct or ethical discipline. The second is meditation or meditative concentration. And then the third is wisdom.
好，那么我们首先我要给大家讲一下啊，我们为什么你要守戒啊？守戒，有什么对我们有什么帮助啊？那我从两个方面给大家介绍这个守戒的功德和利益。
So I'd like to now talk about why it is that we go about or need to go about upholding ethical discipline and keeping vows, and I'd like to speak about this from two perspectives.
首先啊，功德啊，福报，从这个福报和功德的角度来讲啊，守戒的功德确实是不可思议的。佛经里面有一个释迦牟尼佛亲口讲的啊，有一个守戒的功德他说，比如说有两个人啊，那么其中一个人呢啊，他去供佛啊，那他怎么样供佛呢？就是不是一般的供品啊，它就是用金银珠宝，这是我们人类啊的这些各种各样的非常非常啊价格昂贵的这些珠宝啊，非常罕见的、非常稀有的这些珠宝啊。那么不是一个两个啊，就是这个珠宝能够充满啊。三千大千世界的这么多的供品啊，然后去供佛啊，不是供一个佛、两个佛，供过去的、现在的、未来的啊，所有的佛，然后这个时间也不是一天两天啊，就是几百万年、几千万年这样子供佛的话，那么这个有多少个这个功德呢？那么这个功德呢，确实。是只能说这个功德是不可思议的，这是没办法表达的啊！供佛有这么大的这个功德，但是如果另外一个人去守戒的话啊，比如说像我们现在这样，正好是现在这个年代啊，守戒的话就是有一定的难度啊，因为我们每一个人的这个内心的这个欲望啊，还有就是就各种各样的外面的这个条件啊等等，守戒是不是很容易，有一定的难度的时候，如果一个人啊去只守一条戒啊，守一条戒，而且时间很短，只有24小时啊，那么这个功德啊，这个守戒的功德呢，远远超过了这个供佛的，我们刚才讲的这种供佛的功德啊。那么这样子大家啊，就想想这个功德有多大。
So the first perspective that I'd like to speak from is the point of view of the great merit of taking ethical vows.Indeed, the merit associated with taking on vows of ethical discipline can only be described as inconceivable. And in the Buddhist scriptures, an example of this is given. It's described, the merit of making an offering to the Buddha is described as large as the following terms. It's the same as making offerings of the most precious human substances available, gold, silver, and other precious metals, in quantity, the size, enough to fill 3,000 universes, in time, not just a short offering, but also a very long period of time, making offerings not just to the present Buddhas, but the Buddhas of the past, the present and the future too. So an offering on this scale clearly is a very, very vast and meritorious undertaking indeed. Nevertheless, it is said that a person who is unable to undertake, who is able to take on ethical vows, particularly in this age of ours where it, for reasons of the external environment that we live in, as well as the state of our own personal desires, taking vows is not an easy thing to do. If in this environment a person is able to take even just one vow, and even just for a period of 24 hours, then the merit generated by so doing would be even greater. In fact, not just a little bit greater, but would far transcend the merit associated with the previous example of the offering made to Buddhas on such a huge scale.
好，这是一个啊，还有一个呢，我们还没有受戒的时候，我们还没有受戒的时候呢，比如说我们去行善啊，做善事的时候才有功德，才有福报啊。我们没有去做什么善事，比如说我们工作的时候啊，吃饭的时候啊，睡觉的时候啊，聊天的时候是没有什么功德的。但是如果受戒啊，受了戒以后呢，自从受戒的这个瞬间就开始啊，如果这个戒还没有破啊，这样子的话，那么不仅仅是我们啊心善的时候有功德，而且我们不心善的时候啊，就是吃饭聊天，包括晚上睡觉的时候，都把这个戒律的这个功德啊，戒律的功德呢，就像一条很大的河流一样，它就不24小时不间断的增长啊，增长就越来越增长，越来越增长。所以我们不心善的时候啊，没有去做什么善根的时候，这个戒律的功德，只要这个戒律还在，没有去破啊，那这个就功德就越来越大，越来越大。所以我们就是像现代人没有太多的时间去做善事的人来说，这个受一两条戒确实是非常非常划算的。
We can also say that when we have not yet taken any vows or have not pledged to uphold a particular kind of ethical discipline, then the way that we generate or accumulate merit is through undertaking virtuous actions. When we're not undertaking virtuous actions, such as when we're sleeping or whatever, then we're not accumulating merit. However, from the very point in time that we do undertake to uphold some level of vows, then our merit from this point is like a river that continues to flow. And our merit continues to accumulate not only when we're undertaking positive action, but even when we are in idle states as well, such as when we're sleeping or when we're eating, when we're conversing with people. The momentum of the merit of upholding ethical discipline works like this. So from the point of view of busy people in today's world who might not have so much time to undertake all kinds of virtuous action, then you could say that taking a couple of vows is not a bad deal.
另外一个呢，就是因为我们受了戒以后就有约束啊，有约束的话，我们平时都不去，不太会去做一些让自己特别的惭愧、特别内疚、特别后悔的事情啊。那这样子的话，我们打坐的时候啊，打坐的时候，因为我们没有太多的内疚，没有太多的后悔、惭愧这样子的事情，所以打坐的时候呢，心啊能够平静下来啊，对打坐持戒对打坐有非常大的帮助。佛教里面讲，有持有戒就有定，有定就有慧啊，就是这个原因啊。如果我们没有约束的话，我们会去做很多很多让自己特别感到后悔、惭愧这样子的事情。那这种事情多了以后呢， 当我们稍微静下来的时候，然后心就根本没有办法去想什么，专心的去想什么事情，把这些后悔呀、惭愧呀全部都出来了，所以心静不下来的。所以守节对这个禅定是有非常非常大的帮助。
So in addition to the merit of taking vows, it's also possible to look at the benefit of vow keeping from its relationship to our meditation practice. If we haven't restrained our behavior through vow taking, then it's possible that we might undertake all kinds of acts that cause us to feel guilt and cause us to feel a strong sense of regret.Then when we sit down to meditate, it will be very difficult to bring our minds into a state of calmness and tranquility. Thoughts of regret and thoughts of guilt concerning actions that we've undertaken will constantly arise and will thus affect our meditative, the quality of our meditative practice. So that's why we say that first that we have a foundation of ethical conduct,then meditative concentration, and then based on that, wisdom. If we don't restrain ourselves through committing to ethical conduct, then it's possible that we will do all kinds of things which will generate these negative states of mind, regret, guilt, etc., and this will have a negative impact on our meditative practice.
好，这个就是我们今天啊，为什么要守节的一个简单的原因理由。
So that's just a couple of simple reasons as to why we should go about upholding ethical discipline and vows.
好，接下来给大家介绍一下这个节啊，居士节。那么居士节一共有五条节啊，一共有五条节啊，但是大家不用害怕。不一定要守五条戒啊，根据自己的情况啊，自己决定。比如说，你们自己觉得我可以守五条戒，那就守五条戒啊。如果我觉得五条戒我没办法守，我守四条戒就可以守四条戒、三条戒啊，甚至是就是两条戒也可以的。那就是守多少条戒啊，就是。你们决定啊，不是我来给你们安排，你们就根据自己的实际的情况啊，自己决定收两条戒、三条戒、五条戒。
So the five precepts, there are five separate precepts. This is not something that people should feel unduly frightened of. However, it's not necessary that everyone take all five of the precepts. This is something that you can evaluate in light of your own individual circumstances. So it's possible to take four, it's possible to take three, even two it's possible to take. So this is something that everyone needs to decide for themselves.
好，我们今天我们在座的人啊，至少我们所有人至少守两条戒是没有问题的。
Of everyone sitting here tonight, taking two vows at least shouldn't be a problem.
那么我把五条戒一个一个给大家讲啊。那么你们就是听到了以后呢，如果觉得这条戒我能做得到这样子的话，那就下决心啊，我要守这条戒了，确定啊。如果觉得这个我暂时没办法守这样子的话，那就。自己决定啊，这个我暂时不守了，我要看下一个我能不能守，这个我暂时不守，这样子要确定，守和不守自己决定。
So Khenpo is now going to go through each of the five precepts and explain a bit about them. While he is doing so, everyone can think to themselves whether or not the particular precept in question is one they are willing and able to take.And if you are, then make a resolve in your mind that you are going to take on this precept. And if it's not one that you think you're able to take on for the time being, then that's fine too.
好，第一条戒啊，第一条戒就是不喝酒。
So the first precept is not to drink alcohol.
好，这个我想我们大多数的人可以守，但是一部分的人呢没有办法守啊，但是没关系的，这个守和不守都是自由的，自己决定啊。那么守的话，首先我们还要讲，要稍微要讲清楚一点啊。首先什么叫做酒啊，佛教就对这个酒的定义是什么呢啊，只要有两个条件就叫做酒啊。第一个，酒味很明显的啊，叫做，这是一个。第二个，如果喝多了能够喝醉人的啊，这种饮料啊，那么这种饮料只要有这两个，具备这两个条件的话，那不管是红的、白的、甜的、酸的，都叫做酒。
So this vow is probably one that the majority of people here will be able to take, but probably a minority will not feel themselves ready to take anyway. It doesn't matter. It's important, first of all, though, to clarify how we define alcohol in relation to this vow. From the point of view of Buddhism, alcohol is defined by two things.First of all, whether it has a strongly noticeable alcoholic smell, and secondly, whether it is a substance when drunk in a large amount has the capacity to intoxicate a person. And if this is the case, then it doesn't matter whether it's red or white or sweet or sour, it's all alcohol for the purposes of this vow.
所以葡萄酒、红酒什么药酒都是酒。
So all different types of wine, medicinal wine, medicinal liquor, etc. All of these are forms of alcohol.
好，这叫做酒。第二喝，什么叫做喝喝酒的这个概念是什么呢？那外用可以的，用酒精消毒没有问题甚至是在口腔里面呢，需要用酒精消毒的话，我们用酒精消毒，然后呢，不要这个酒不要咽下去吐出来也可以的。
So the second thing to clarify is what we actually mean by drinking or imbibing alcohol, and here it's important to clarify that it's okay to use alcohol in an external way, for example, to use alcohol to sterilize a wound. It's also okay to use alcohol to sterilize a wound inside the mouth. And even if a bit is swallowed, we can spit it out. These forms of contact with alcohol are all permissible from the point of view of this vow.
还有一个就是不知道的情况下喝了也没问题的，就比如说他以为是水，喝下去了才发现是酒那也没问题的。
It's also not a problem if we consume alcohol when we are ignorant about the fact that what we're consuming is alcohol. So for example, if weThought that what we were drinking is water and took a gulp, then this wouldn't be a problem.
如果有一天精神失常了在这种情况下喝了也没问题的。
If we had a problem where, if there was some point where we lost control of our mental faculties and accidentally drank some alcohol, then this wouldn't be a problem either.
那什么叫做喝呢？就是明明知道这个是酒，然后就是想喝，故意喝，一口一口的咽下去了，叫做喝酒。
So from the point of view of this vow, what it means to consume or to drink alcohol is when we are completely cognizant of the fact that what the substance in question is is alcohol, and we.Drink it one mouthful after the other. This is drinking alcohol.
还有这个量喝了多少算喝酒呢？比如说，这个一口一大口一小口的一样，一口什么叫一口呢？这个酒的量 足够咽下去，叫做喝酒。比如说一滴水，一滴酒，两滴酒滴在嘴巴里面，但是它是没办法咽下去的，所以不叫喝酒。
And then in terms of what quantity constitutes drinking alcohol, it would have to be an amount that is able to be swallowed. So one drop or two drops on the tongue, because they wouldn't be able to be swallowed in any meaningful sense, wouldn't be considered as in transgression of this vow.
还有就是我们也超采的时候里面有些时候放一点点酒啊，这个料酒，还有些点心有些食物食品，有些药里面呢也有酒。那么这些可不可以吃呢？可以和不可以的界限是什么？就是当我们把这些东西吃的时候、喝的时候，如果吃得出这个酒味那就这个不能吃不能喝如果吃不出虽然有酒精的成分不管是食物菜肴虽然有酒精的成分，但是我们吃的时候呢确实是没有这个感觉，那这样子就可以放心的吃。
Sometimes we use wine in cooking, we put liqueurs in sweets, and we use alcohol in medicinal tonics. And so far as we are permitted to consume alcohol in these contexts, the test is whether or not when we eat or drink the food or substance in question, we can taste discernibly the flavor of alcohol. And if we can, then we shouldn't be eating or drinking what we are. And if we can't taste the taste of alcohol, then we can go ahead eating or drinking without any major concerns.
中国人就比较喜欢吃醪糟。如果要吃醪糟，用水煮，然后把酒味取消了以后才可以吃。
Chinese people are very fond of eating a fermented rice soup, and the way that we could make this permissible would be to boil the fermented rice soup until the alcohol flavor had disappeared.
好，还有一个呢，我们学藏传佛教的有些时候我们会做回宫，那么回宫的这个宫品里面呢有一点点酒那这个酒可不可以喝呢？也不可以喝的。
There's another important context to talk about, and that is the Ganachakra or the Tsok feast in Tibetan Buddhism. In this ritual, there is also some alcohol to be consumed.
但是如果我们参加了这个会供的话呢，我们还是要表个态我接受这个就要表个态但是不能喝。怎么又不喝又表态呢？就是左手的这个倒数第二叫做无名指我们把无名指蘸在这个酒里面然后就吐在自己的嘴唇里面这个我们就表示我接受但是呢我目前还没有能力就一口一口的去喝，所以我不喝这样子的话，那就既没有犯戒，又得到这个参加会供的功德，一举两得。
So in this context, we're not able to consume the alcohol in the Tsok ritual. So what do we do then? How do we go about making a gesture of accepting this offering whilst upholding our vows at the same time? What we can do is take the tip of our fourth finger on our left hand, dip it into the alcohol, and then bring it to our lips.In so doing this, we are making a gesture of accepting the offering. We are also not breaking our vows. So you could say it's really two birds with the one stone.
好，这个给大家已经介绍的比较清楚了。现在有20秒钟的时间，自己想一想，到底要受还是不受。
So everyone probably has a clear idea about what this vow entails. Now you have about 20 seconds to decide whether or not this is a vow that you'd like to take.
如果要守的话，我们现在要这样子发心啊，我从今天起啊到死为止，我不喝酒啊，不但是我不喝酒，而且我受啊这个不喝酒的这条戒啊。如果我们准备守戒的话，那这样子下决心啊。如果暂时不准备守的话，那就像啊我这个暂时不守这样子就可以了。
So if this is a vow that you'd like to take, then it's necessary to resolve in your mind that not only will you not consume alcohol from this day onwards until the moment of your death, but that you will also uphold the vow not to consume alcohol for this duration too.
好，现在应该有20秒了啊，我们能够守九戒的有多少人？我们举个手看一看，能够守这条戒的。
20 seconds is probably up. Please raise your hand if you'd like to take this vow.
好，非常好，我们大部分的人可以守。好，可以了，这是第一条戒。
This is very good. It seems the majority of people are able to commit to taking this vow or this precept. Now we're going to move on to the next one.
好，接下来第二条戒啊，第二条戒，第二条戒是什么呢？不杀人。
The next precept is no taking of human life, no killing of human life.
不杀人啊，我们不会去杀成人，我们也不会去杀婴儿啊。但是有一个问题，我们会杀胎儿。
So, of course, we don't kill adults and we don't kill children. However, there is one problematic area, and that is in respect to the killing of fetuses.
胎儿啊，从佛每全世界每个国家的法律不一样啊，杀死一个堕胎和杀死一个故意杀人。是一样不一样都不有很多不同的法律，但是呢，从佛教的因果的角度来讲，这两个是一样的，因为两个都是生命，不仅仅是生命，而且两个都是同样是人类的生命，所以故意去杀害一个成人或者一个婴儿和故意去堕胎这两个的罪过。
The laws of countries concerning the seriousness of terminating pregnancies and murdering people vary a lot. However, from the point of view of the Buddhist teachings, the karmic consequences of intentionally killing an adult human or a live human are the same as killing a life form when it is a fetus.
好，然后这个不堕胎就是堕胎，我们刚才讲了，就是杀人，而且这个非常的这个罪过确实是非常严重非常严重。我们可能很多人就堕过很多胎那么这个。大家必须要高度重视什么叫做高度重视呢？就是要忏悔要好好的忏悔。那么忏悔的方法呢？佛教里面有很多很多忏悔的方法。大家必须要过去的这些堕胎，大家必须要忏悔。
So the negative karmic consequences of aborting a fetus are extremely serious. They are on par with taking an adult human life. So for this reason, maybe many people here tonight have terminated numerous pregnancies in this life. It's something in any case that we need to regard very seriously. By saying this, what I am really referring to is the need to have to confess and to have an attitude towards purifying our karma in respect of this action.
如果我们今天啊，就是下决心啊，受这条戒，从此以后不堕胎、不杀人，这样子的话，其实这个就是最最最好的这个忏悔的方法之一。
If tonight we're able to take this vow and from this point onwards vow never to take another human life, then actually this is the best form of confession and purification of karma that is available to us.
比如说我们今天受这条戒的话，那么受戒的当下啊，那我们过去的这个堕胎的这些罪过，很大的程度上就得到了清净啊。很大程度上就是忏悔了。
In fact, it's possible from the very moment that we take on this precept that the negative karma stemming from our past action in this way can be to a very large degree purified.
堕胎啊，故意去堕胎啊，虽然是这个是杀生啊，但是还没有怀孕的时候。采取措施避孕啊，那么这个就是不是杀生啊，所以佛教徒啊，尤其是这个受了这条戒的人啊，必须在这个采取措施这个上面必须高度重视。
Adopting contraceptive measures in order to prevent a pregnancy, however, is not considered killing life. So for this reason, we as Buddhists and people who take this vow in particular need to pay particular attention to the issue of contraception.
因为这个时候啊，还没有一个生命啊，这个时候还没有一个生命，所以这个我们可以确定啊，这个不是杀生。
Because at this point we don't have a human life that we can speak of, so therefore there is no issue of taking human life.
如果在这个采取措施这个问题上，大家啊能够稍微注意一下，这样子的话。那么这个不杀人的这条戒应该是我们大家都可以守的。
If everyone is willing to be diligent in respect of the issue of contraception, then probably this precept is one that everybody can take.
好，接下来的这个大家也就是刚才这二十秒钟的时间当中，大家要思考一下要不要杀人。
So in the next 20 seconds, please give consideration as to whether or not you are willing to undertake not to kill humans.
好，那么我们如果守这条戒的话，那我们现在要这样子下决心啊，我从现在起啊到死为止，我不故意杀人啊，不故意杀人的意思就是说无意当中，比如说我们开车啊，开车。就是发生了这个交通事故啊，撞死了人等等啊，这个是不犯戒的，他因为他不是故意的，无意当中啊，无意的这些意外的都不会犯戒的，就是故意啊，所以呢，就是说我从现在起到死为止，我不故意啊杀人啊，不管是成人、婴儿、胎儿，我不故意杀。不但是不杀，而且我要受这个不杀人的这条戒啊，要这样子下决心。
So this precept concerns the intentional taking of human life. So by this we mean that one would need to kill another human withfull intention for it to be a transgression of this vow. If we accidentally killed someone in a car accident, for example, then because this wouldn't have been an intentional action, then it wouldn't it wouldn't be considered as a breaking of this vow. So for the purposes of taking this precept, what we need to do is make the resolve, a strong resolve in our minds, that from this point onwards until the moment of our death, that we will not intentionally kill another human life, whether that be in an adult, child, or fetal form.
好，我们现在准备守这条戒，大家自己想好守还是不守，自己决定如果能够守的话，我们能够守这条戒的，大家举个手，我们看看多少人能够守，应该大家都可以守的。
Those who are willing to take this vow, please raise your hands.
好，非常好，好，可以了。好，现在就是我们已经两条戒了现在就是第三条戒第三条戒是非常简单的很容易的这是应该我们在座的所有的人都可以守，而且守了以后呢，也不会反的。很简单，很容易的。
So the next precept, the third precept, is a relatively straightforward one. It's one that's easy to keep, so it should be one that everybody here is able to take on.
但是对有些人来说肯定是不容易的，不简单的。但是我想我们在座的人呢，我觉得应该是简单的。
Even though to some people it's not an easy vow to keep, I would say that for everyone sitting here tonight, that it is.
那这条戒是什么戒呢？比如说他想骗人他想为了骗人明明知道自己没有神通没有神通，然后就为了欺骗人说我有神通那神通是什么呢？比如说我能够看到天堂，能够看到地狱能够看到谁的前世谁的后世看到天人，看到鬼，看到神等等，就是以这样子的方式去欺骗人就是这个就是不，就是第三条戒，就是不做这件事情那么这个应该大家都可以守的。
So this precept prescribes the making claims about one's supernatural and clairvoyant abilities with the purpose of cheating and deceiving others.
这条戒我们第一我们也不会去说的，我想其实我们说了也不一定有人相信。
I'm sure that we wouldn't go around making these kinds of claims to start with, and of course, even if we did, probably not that many people would believe us.
所以我们还是受了戒比较好，比较划算。
So it's probably a good thing that we do take this vow.
好，这个就守好还是不守，大家当然是自己决定，做好准备如果要守，那大家这样子想我从现在起到死为止，我就不说这样子的妄语撒谎不是所有的撒谎，就这一个我就不以这样子的方式去这个欺骗人不但是不做这件事，而且我要受戒要这样子下决心。
So this is something that everyone please think about for yourselves, whether you would like to take it, and if you would, then please make the resolve that from this point onwards until the moment of your death, you will not tell lies of this nature. And it's important to note that this is particularly about lies of this nature, not lies about other things in general, in order to deceive others. And not only will you not engage in this behavior, but you will also uphold the vow not to tell lies of this nature as well for this duration of time.
好，我们能够守这条戒的，我们有多少？我们举个手，应该大家都可以守的。好好，非常好。好，现在我们已经有三条戒了我建议我们今天在座的年轻人 也就是说需要上班，还需要上班，需要做生意，需要养家糊口的，就守这三条戒就可以了。
My recommendation would be that younger members of the audience, those who are still looking after their families, they're upholding a livelihood, that they keep these three precepts, and it's probably enough in itself.
就是你们在这个五条戒里面呢，已经受了三条戒，那三条戒已经受了大部分的戒，所以呢。其他的两条戒不守的话，你们的地位也已经很高了。
So because in taking these three vows, you already would have taken three of the five, and therefore the majority of the vows, your status is already extremely high.
而且也不会有什么风险。
And there are no major risks from your point of view either.
然后这三个啊，也不会影响到我们的工作和生活。比如说，除了喝酒以外，喝酒呢，可能是有些时候有应酬，有些时候可能不太方便啊。除了这个以外，我们不杀人，不说刚才讲的这种妄语，这跟我们的生活有什么影响啊？跟我们工作有什么影响啊？没有什么影响。
So with the exception of not drinking alcohol, which may have some impact on certain people's social and work lives, the other two vows, not to tell lies about extraordinary and supernatural abilities and not to take human life, these are not vows that will impact on our work or everyday lives in any manifest way.
好，另外的两条戒啊，我们刚才五条戒当中另外的两条戒呢，我们就老人家可以考虑守这两条戒。
The remaining two vows are ones that I would recommend that elderly members of the audience consider taking.
比如说70岁的、75岁这样子以上的人可以守。
For example, those who are 70 years and above, or even 75 years and above.
好，那么两条戒是什么呢？第一条戒。就是不偷盗啊，不偷盗就是不偷别人的东西啊。但是你们很多人想，年轻人想，我也不会偷别人的东西啊，为什么老年人才收呢？为什么我不可以收呢？但是这个我们呢、就是作为一个佛教徒，不会故意去偷别人的东西。但是呢，需要做生意的时候，这个里面就有很多的问题，比如说偷税漏税。也是偷盗。
So this next precept is no stealing or no taking of what is not given. Many people may think, well, young people should be able to take this vow too, take the vow against stealing. However, in respect of this, it's certainly the case that as Buddhists, we wouldn't deliberately go about taking other people's belongings. For the purposes of this vow, however, stealing is defined in a way that makes it rather easy to transgress. For example, during our business dealings, it's possible to engage easily in behavior that constitutes stealing, even evading taxes and using loopholes in the financial system is all stealing from the point of view of this vow.
比如说我们坐飞机，我们的行李超重了，故意不买票，也会啊，也会也算偷盗。
For example, if when we're taking the airplane, our luggage is too heavy, but we deliberately evade paying the excess, then this is also stealing.
还有做生意的时候，比如说这个是它的成本是100块钱。然后就我说啊，我这个成本是200块钱，因为你是我的老顾客，我以成本价卖给你啊。
When we do business, when we sell things to customers, we claim that the cost price of an object is $100. Well, the cost price is $100, but we claim to the customer that it's actually $200, but that on account of them being our old and loyal customer, we're going to give them a bargain, then this is also stealing from the point of view of this vow.
那是不是我们受了这个戒，就是不是根本就没办法做生意呢？当然不是了。比如说 我这个成本确实是100块钱啊，但是我要买200块钱，那我不说这个成本是多少，我说我的卖价就是200块钱，我不打折啊，那么人家买了我就赚了100块钱，那这个叫做赚钱，这个不是偷盗，我没有说，我没有撒谎。
Of course, does this mean that it's not possible to uphold this vow and do business? And no, it doesn't mean this at all. For example, in this situation, it would upholding this vow in, would mean not making claims about the cost price of an item. For example, this item that has a cost price of $100, we just simply wouldn't say that. We'd say that our buying price is $200. In the process, we'd make a $100 profit. But this is an example of making money rather than taking from people by making dishonest representations.
还有比如说我们在别人的公司工作那么这个公司就有明显的规定这个员工就不能用他们的公家的公司的公用的这些财产比如说打电话呀等等不能用那么我明明知道这个规矩然后我就用这个他们的公司的电话给家人打电话聊天那么这个电话费超过一定的时候也叫做偷盗。
Or for example, if we work for a company that has very clear rules about what constitutes unlawfully using the company resources, then if we were, for example, to use the company telephone to make a long telephone call to our families, then this would also be stealing.
那这个价格要超过多少钱呢？比如说在中国大陆现在的物价和现在的这个人民币的价值来算的话，大概就是10块钱人民币，然后呢，新西兰是多少？你们自己算。
So in terms of the value of the object in question that would be necessary for stealing to be constituted if this item was taken, we can assess it in terms of about 10 renminbi according to its current value in China, so probably about $2.
好，这个我们很多需要做生意的人呢，暂时不熟的话就比较安全。
So probably for people who need to do quite a lot of business, it's probably safer for them not to take on this vow.
当然，像一定要收的话，当然也可以收的。
However, if you really want to take it, then of course it's possible for you to do so.
好，这是最后这是第四条啊，现在是最后一个，最后一个呢叫做不邪淫啊，不邪淫是什么？就是不去迫害别人的家庭。
And the final and fifth precept is no sexual misconduct. And what we're talking about here is engaging in behavior that disrupts or destroys other people's households.
如果仅仅是不迫害别人的家庭这个我们很多人也可以做得到。但是呢，它还有一些其他的内容比如说同性恋等等，还有其他的内容。那么这些可以还是不可以犯戒还不犯戒，大家去学习一下比如说像回灯之光还有宗喀巴大师的这个菩提道次第光轮这些里面都有讲得很清楚的，所以大家先去学习学习好了以后呢，如果觉得没有问题到时候可以补因为我们今天我这一条就是没有讲得特别的详细，所以呢就是你们也不是很明白，所以就在这种情况下守的话是有就以后就不容易这个坚持，所以呢我建议年轻人先暂时不要去守然后我刚才讲的这个年龄超过的人可以守，应该是没问题的。
So it's not just this kind of behavior that is covered by this precept. Actually, there is quite a detailed explanation as to the kinds of behavior that would constitute sexual misconduct for the purposes of this vow. I would recommend that everyone learn about in more detail for themselves what this vow actually does cover. For example, it's explained quite fully in my Wisdom Light book series. It's also explained very clearly in Tsongkhapa's graded stages of the path. In any case, it's probably I haven't gone into great detail about it this evening, so even if people were to take it, then they would be doing so in a way where they weren't particularly clear about its full scope. So I'd recommend that tonight young people don't take this vow. The people who I would say could take it are, as I said before, those who are over about 70 or 75 years of age.
好，最后的，最后的两条我们不举手哦，然后自己心里决定就可以了。
So in respect of these last two vows, we're not going to raise our hands. Just decide for yourself in your own minds whether or not you'd like to take them.
啊，大家听清楚了吗
？Is everybody clear about this?
好，那我们现在准备。收解啊，那我这个等一下我们收解的时候呢，要念一下这个仪轨啊。那么这个仪轨呢是韩文的啊，我们今天还没有来得及准备这个英文的啊，但是没关系的，我先把这个仪轨的内容给大家简单的说一下，然后我们等一下啊将英文的听不懂。韩语的人呢也没问题，刚才自己已经确定了收多少条节啊，那么已经确定了，那确定了以后呢，现在就是想啊，要知道这个衣柜在降什么呢，就是在降啊，我要收多少多少条节啊，我要皈依啊，我要皈依，我要收节啊，他就是在表达啊，他就在表达这个意思，就知道这个就可以了，然后语言呢我们用任何语言都没问题的，这个语言的内容听不懂没问题的，内容我们之前就已经给大家讲清楚了，所以没问题的。
So from here, Khenpo is going to read a liturgy and have everyone recite after him at certain points. It wasn't possible due to time tonight to prepare this in an English version, so Khenpo is going to be reciting it in a Chinese version. He's aware that here this evening are members of the audience who don't speak Chinese, but that's fine. Essentially, the content of the liturgy is that which we have spoken about tonight. It is essentially expressing a willingness to firstly, take refuge, and then secondly, undertake lay precepts in however, whatever number you individually decide to do so. So in actual fact, it doesn't matter that it's going to be read in Chinese. Everyone is clear about the meaning, and this is the important thing.
好，这个仪轨的意思呢，大德一心垂念我，然后我名要说出我某某某人啊，从此时起我要终身皈依佛啊，一辈子要皈依佛两祖尊，皈依法，皈依佛法立于尊啊，皈依僧中中尊啊，反正这个意思就是我要皈依佛，皈依法，皈依僧，然后呢请大德从此时起，从现在起啊，乃至终身一辈子把我作为一个佛教的居士视我为居士，就是把我作为一个皈依的这个皈依三宝的居士意思，这个衣柜的内容就是这个意思。
So the meaning of the liturgy is to seek the venerableblessing to take refuge in the three objects of the Buddha, the Dharma, and the Sangha, and also to be accepted as a lay Buddhist.
好，我们现在准备守节啊。我们除了有一位出家师父就不需要站起来坐着，那么其他的大家都 站起来向这个释迦牟尼佛的佛像磕三个头慢慢的磕不着急。
So with the exception of the ordained member of the audience, we have everybody else please stand up and do three prostrations before the Buddha image at the front of the room.
好，向释迦牟尼佛佛像磕三个头，慢慢的来，不着急。好，磕了三个头以后，大家就跪在地上，向释迦牟尼佛跪下来，两手合掌。
Please bring your palms together in front of you and kneel in front of the Buddha image.
好，这样子跪下来。好，然后呢，我们现在准备这个收戒。那么皈依和收戒皈依和收戒。对我们来说，在我们的生命当中是一个很深深的、很重要的一个事情。
So, now we are preparing to actually take the vows in so far as, this is concerned in our human lives. This is an extremely important and solemn occasion.
所以大家一定要专心用心去守这个皈依戒，否则的话，我们光是念一下这个依皈得不到戒。大家要专心专注。
So everybody, please take the vows with great sincerity in your minds. Simply reciting the words is not sufficient.
好，然后我再重复一下我们刚才讲的，简单的重复一下我们现在收戒有三个步骤。
So I'm just going to briefly repeat what I said before. There are three steps in taking the vows.
第一个就是要发菩提心，大家要想，我要让天下所有的众生解脱成佛，所以就是为了达到这个目标，我下定决心我要成佛。为了成佛，我今天要皈依收皈依戒和居士戒，这样子下决心。这个是第一个步骤。
So the first step is the making of a generation of bodhicitta, and here we are referring to the wish that all beings attain liberation and Buddhahood, and that in respect of this goal that we individually commit to, we here tonight are taking the refuge vows and the lay precepts.
好，第二个步骤就是皈依。皈依的时候，我们下决心我从现在起生生死死，释迦牟尼佛就是我的唯一的导师，释迦牟尼佛的法就是我的唯一的所学的法、所修的法，然后学释迦牟尼佛法的僧众就是我的唯一的道友这样子下决心，这是第二个步骤，就是皈依。
And the second stage is the solemn pledge that from this day onwards, for the rest of our lives to come, that the Buddha will be our only spiritual guide, that the Buddha Dharma will be our only spiritual teachings, and that the Buddhist Sangha will be our only spiritual companions.
好，第三个步骤呢，我们刚才有些人是两条戒，有些三条戒，有些是五条戒那不管是多少条戒，我们自己决定要守的这些戒，我们要像我就是比如说我们守三条戒的话，我从今天起不喝酒、不杀人、不说我们刚才讲的这种妄语我不但是不做这些事情，而且我从现在开始收这三条戒这样子下决心，这是第三个步骤。
And then the third step is in relation to the lay precepts.Please bring to mind the number of precepts that you have committed to upholding and resolve in your minds that from this day onwards until the moment of your death, that you will not engage in the behavior that is prescribed by the precept. And not only will you not engage in the behavior, but you will also uphold the vow for the period of time as well.
好，我们现在啊，心里做好了准备以后呢，我们要向在释迦牟尼佛的佛像前要表达。表达的方式呢，这里有一个仪柜啊，就是给大家刚才讲的这个仪柜。那这个仪柜的意思呢，我们刚才已经讲过了。那我现在我来念这个仪柜，大家跟着我念，我们念三遍啊，反复重复三遍。最后一遍结束的时候呢，我们每一个人就获得两种戒，一个是皈依戒，一个是居士戒。
So having mentally prepared ourselves in this way, the next step, Khenpo will recite the liturgy and everyone will repeat after him what he says. And after this repetition has been performed three times, then everyone will haveobtained two sets of vows, firstly the refuge vows and secondly the lay precepts.
好，现在大家做好准备跟着我念。
Everyone, please prepare yourselves to repeat after me.
大德一心垂念我。
大德一心垂念我。
要说出自己的名字啊。
And say your name here.
我名。
我名。
从此时起，
终身皈依佛，
两祖尊，皈依法，利欲尊，皈依僧，众种尊，请达德，从此时起。乃至终身时至，视我为居士。好，这是第一遍啊，再来第二遍。
So that was the first time. Now we're going to do the second repetition.
大德一心垂念我。
大德一心垂念我。
自己的名字啊。我名。从此时起，
终身皈依佛，
两祖尊，皈依法，利欲尊，皈依僧，众种尊，请达德，从此时起，乃至终身时至。
视我为居士。
好，再来最后一遍。最后一遍结束的时候，我们的这个两条戒，从此以后，我们正式的进入了佛门，成为释迦牟尼佛的四众弟子之一。
So this is going to be the final repetition, and when this repetition is complete, then we will have obtained two sets of vows and will be formally considered members of the fourfold community of the Buddha students.
大德一心垂念我。
大德一心垂念我。
好，我们的名字啊。我名。从此时起，
终身皈依佛，
两祖尊，皈依法，利欲尊，皈依僧，众种尊，请达德，从此时起，乃至终身时至。
视我为居士。
好，然后我说此乃方便的时候，大家要说善哉啊。
When Khenpo says what he says, then please repeat 善哉。
他没喏，此乃方便，善哉。好， 好，你们推，如果推疼的话，可以坐到座位上啊。年轻人推不疼的话，还要等一会儿。
If your knees are sore, then feel free to sit down. For young people who are more robust, then please keep kneeling.
好，还有一个衣柜，我们要念一遍。念这个衣柜的时候，大家要想啊。那我们刚才收节了，那以后要持节，那怎么持节呢？我们向过去的阿罗汉学习。过去的阿罗汉，他们怎么持节，我们就怎么持节。我们向他们学习啊，这样子发心，然后又跟着我念。
And we're going to repeat or recite another liturgy now. Now that we have undertaken to uphold the vows, how do we go about doing so? According to this liturgy, we vow to do so by following in the example of the arhats of the past, following in the example of the way that they upheld their ethical discipline.
好，现在再来最后一个。愿是垂念我，
愿是垂念我，
往昔圣者阿罗汉，
往昔圣者阿罗汉，
如何断除杀生？
而不杀生，
如是。要说出自己的名字啊。
Say your name at this point.
我名，已从此时起，乃至终身时至，断除杀生，而不杀生。我以此意志，向圣者阿罗汉，
向圣者阿罗汉，
至学处，
虽修，
虽学，
虽
作，
此外，
往昔圣者阿罗汉，如何断除？好，这个时候我们刚才啊，没有受不头道的这个解的都不要念啊，受了头道解的跟着我念啊。
The next recitation, if you didn't take the vow, that prescribes stealing or taking what's not given, then it's not necessary for you to repeat after Khenpo.
盗取。好，然后受了嘛，没有受这个不谐音的解的。都不要念啊，都不要念啊，然后就受了这条戒的跟着我念啊，邪淫。
Oh, the next one, if you didn't take the vow against sexual misconduct, then it's not necessary to repeat here.
好，我重新念啊，邪淫。好，然后大家一起，所有人啊。
And this next one, everyone, please repeat after Khenpo.
妄语。好，然后我们没有受不喝酒的戒的都不念啊，受了的跟着我念啊。
And only repeat after Khenpo here if you took the vow, against consuming alcohol.
古酒，
纠纷，
能醉，方易致无。好，然后大家一起啊，如。大家一起。
And this one, everyone, please recite together.
如实，要自己的名字啊。
And please say your name here.
我名，已从此时起，乃至终身时至。好，然后我们受了不偷盗的，跟着我念啊。
And please repeat here only if you took the vow.Against stealing.
不盗。
不盗。
然后受了不谐音的跟着我念啊。
And this one is only for those who've taken the vow against committing sexual misconduct.
不谐音。
不谐
音。然后所有人啊。
This one is for everybody.
不妄语。
不妄语。
然后我们受了纠结的跟着我念啊。
And this is only for those who have taken the vow against consuming alcohol.
不饮古酒，
纠
纷，
能醉，
方易致无。好，然后我们受了无条戒的，就说 我以次五指，三条节的就是说我以次三指，两条节的就是说我以次两指。
So at this point, please say the number of vows that you have undertaken to uphold.
我以次五指，想胜者阿罗汉，指学处，虽修，虽学，虽坐。好，然后我说此乃方便的时候，大家说善哉。
When Khenpo says 此乃方便， please say 善哉。
此乃方便，
善哉。
好，大家再站起来向释迦牟尼佛佛像磕三个头。
And please stand up and do another three prostrations in front of the Buddha.
好，请大家坐位，坐回位置。
Everyone, please sit down.
好，我们今天的这个皈依节和居士节都已经讲完了，也给大家熟了。那么大家尽量的。就不要翻节啊。那么如果无意当中或者是没办法的情况下翻节的话，那么首先要去忏悔。忏悔的方法呢，我们念金刚萨埵嗡班赞萨埵洪，念这个金刚萨埵念四十万遍啊。然后这个忏悔的方法呢，书里面讲的比较清楚啊，四十万遍。然后这个忏悔完了以后呢，再去守啊，再去守节就可以。
So that brings us to a completion of tonight's explanation of the refuge and lay precepts, as well as our transmission of the precepts and our refuge vow as well. So from this point on, please everyone strive to uphold their vows and precepts well.If you find yourself having transgressed or broken your vows, then the means of redressing this is to confess for your wrongdoing and perform 40,000 recitations of the Vajrasattva heart mantra. And once you've done this, then you are free to take the vows again.
好，然后我们这个五节居士五节给大家比较清楚的讲了，但是皈依的节有六条节，这个我们今天没有来得及讲，但是很简单的接下来大家自己看书学习就可以，因为我们今天的时间有点晚，所以我们今天不讲大家自己去看这个我们皈依节呢。可以看第一个，我们从什么书上面学呢？第一个宗喀巴大师的《菩提岛次第光论》的皈依里面有，还有一个就是大圆满的前心普贤上师眼角的皈依里面有，还有慧灯之光第二本的皈依里面都有讲得很清楚的，其实这个都不复杂的。
So tonight we were able to go into quite a bit of detail about the content of the five lay precepts. However, in respect of the refuge vows, we didn't talk about the six entailments of taking refuge. These are rather straightforward and simple, though. They're something that you can familiarize yourselves with at home. You can consult Tsongkhapa's gradual stages of the path, or the words of my perfect teacher, or the second volume of Khenpo's Wisdom Light book series, all contain detailed accounts of the refuge vows and the six entailments.
好，我们现在开始做回向。今天我们收了节也收了皈依节，确实是非常非常有意义，我们人生当中的一个比较重大的事情。 那么这个有很大的这个功德。那么我们现在做回向，那回向的意思呢，我们把这个功德分享给天下所有的众生，我们诚心实意的发愿啊，以我们的这个功德能让天下所有的众生健康幸福快乐，很快就能够超越生死轮回啊，获得佛的果位，以这样子的心愿啊做回向。
So now we're going to dedicate the merit of this evening's teaching. Tonight we took the vows of ethical discipline, we took the refuge vows, and as a result generated a great deal of merit for ourselves. So in dedicating the merit, we do so with the aspiration that all living beings obtain temporary happinesses and also achieve the ultimate happinesses of liberation from the sufferings of samsara and eventually attain Buddhahood.
So num de yi tam je zu ba nya dom ne ni be da na pa che jir ga nan ji ma long zu ba zhe bim zo lin zu a zu shu om a hom ban zeng ge zhe ba ma se de hom om a hom谢谢，谢谢大家，阿弥陀佛，大家晚安。Thank you so much.